If Excel formulas and functions have ever confused you, don't worry, you're not alone. Hi, I'm Kevin, and by the end of this video, you'll know exactly how to use them step by step. We'll walk through the most useful formulas, when to use functions, and how to avoid the most common mistakes. Let's dive in. Formulas and functions are the foundation of working with data in Excel, but they're not the same thing. Let's start with a formula. Here I am in Microsoft Excel, and if you'd like to follow along, I've included this sample workbook down below in the description. I want to know how many cookies were sold on Monday and Tuesday. Hopefully you could see that we sold 350 cookies. Just kidding, it's 250. Just making sure you're paying attention. As a quick tip, when I highlight these two cells, Excel shows the sum right here at the bottom in the toolbar. No formula needed at all. But we want to enter a formula, so let's go right up to cell C2. To enter a formula, let's type in an equal sign, and then we're going to add these two numbers. So I have 100, and we want to add 150. I'll enter in the addition sign, and then 150. And then we could press enter. Look at that, it gives me 250. But here's the catch. Let's say that we actually sold 101 cookies on Monday. Here, I'll press enter, and you'll notice that it still shows 250. It doesn't change. That's because I typed in the actual numbers. Instead, we can reference the cells directly. I'll delete this formula right here. Now, let's update this formula. I'll enter in the equal sign, and instead of typing in these numbers, let's click into this cell, here B2, and let's add that to B3. I'll click on this. Then, let's press enter, and there it dynamically calculates the sum. And let's say that Monday's value changes again. So instead of 101, let's type in a 102. Then I'll press enter, and there it reflects the change. Formulas always start with an equal sign, and then they use numbers, cell references, and math operators. Now, we just added two numbers, but formulas can do more than just add. You can also subtract, multiply, and divide. Let's take an example. Let's say I want to know the difference between Monday and Tuesday sales. Let's enter in the equal sign again. Here, I'll take Tuesday and let's subtract Monday. And here we can see that we sold 48 more cookies on Tuesday compared to Monday. Let's now delete these and see what would happen if we sold double the number of cookies on Monday. People really love our cookies. Again, let's enter in the equal sign. And over here, I'll click on cell B2. Now, we want to multiply this by 2. For multiplication, let's enter in the asterisk symbol, and then let's type in a 2, and then press enter. Here you can see we would have sold 204 cookies. Not bad. Let's now look at division. I'd like to know how many times Tuesday's sales were higher than Monday's. Over here, let's delete this value. Again, let's type in the equal sign, and over here, let's take Tuesday's sales, and let's divide by entering in a forward slash, and then I'll click into cell B2 for Monday's sales, and let's press enter. And here we can see that Tuesday was 1.47 times greater than Monday's sales. Just remember, formulas always start with an equal sign. Now, this works great, but what if I want to calculate the total sales for the entire week? So let's go right down into this cell, and let's enter in the equal sign. So right here we had Monday sales, let's add that to Tuesday sales, and add that to Wednesday sales, and add that to Thursday sales. It's starting to get messy really fast. And this is where functions come in. Let's press escape, and right over here let's also delete this formula. And then let's go down into cell B9. Excel has built-in functions that do the heavy lifting for you. We're going to use what's called the sum function. Just like we did with formulas, let's type in an equal sign, and then let's type in the name of this function. Here, I'll type in sum. Over on the left-hand side, you'll see that there are lots of different functions, but right up here, we want to use the sum function. I'll select this. It also inserts a parenthesis. Next, we need to tell Excel what to sum. That's called the argument. Right down below, it gives us a hint. We need to enter in some numbers. So let's go right up above, and I could select each individual cell with all the different numbers. I could insert a comma, And here I could select the next cell, another comma, but here too, that's not saving that much time. So let's hit the backspace key and remove all of that. Instead of going through and selecting one cell by one cell, instead, we could select all of the different values in this column. And down below, you'll see that we'll sum all the values between cell B2 and B8.
Now I could close the parentheses.
I could just hit the enter key, and there I get the sum for the entire week. That's a lot easier. So here's the difference. Formulas are custom calculations you create. Functions, on the other hand, are built-in tools Excel gives you to make those calculations even easier. Every function is a formula, but not every formula uses a function. Now that we've looked at sum, let's look at some of the other most common functions in Excel. These are built-in tools that can save you a ton of time. I'll go back to the top of the sheet and let's focus on average next. This tells you the average number of cookies sold per day. Let's type in the formula and the function. I'll type in the equal sign and let's type in equals average. And here we see the function.
I'll open the parentheses.
And now it wants us to feed in the arguments or all of the different numbers that we would like to average. I'll select the cookie sold for all of the different days of the week. And then let's press enter. And here I could see that we sold on average 190 cookies every day. Not bad. Another useful function is called max. This shows the highest number in a list. Right over here, let's enter in an equal sign, and you can probably guess the name. It's simply max. Then we need to feed in all the different arguments, just like we've been doing. I'll select this, and then let's hit enter. And it looks like it's 354 cookies. People seem to really like eating cookies on Saturday. At the Kevin Cookie Company, we just have to figure out how to make every single day a Saturday. Want to find the smallest value? You could use a function called min. Right over here, let's type in the name. I'll feed in all the different arguments. Let's hit enter, and it looks like it was Thursday. Next, let's try a function called count. This tells you how many numbers are in a range. So right over here, let's type in the function name equals count. I'll feed in all the different arguments and hit enter, and it looks like it's 7. This is perfect for checking if anything is missing. Finally, here's one that's a little different. The function name is if. This lets you apply logic. For example, I could say, if Sunday cookies sold are, let's say, greater than 300, then show great job. Otherwise, say you're making too many YouTube videos.
Let's go up into this cell and let's enter in the equal sign and then type in if and open the parentheses.
Right down below, I see this helpful tooltip that lets me know what arguments I need to feed into this function. Now, first off, it says logical test. Well, I want to know if Sunday cookies sold exceed 300. So over here, I'll refer to this cell with the number of cookies sold on Sunday. Then I'd like to check whether it's greater than, let's say, 300. Next, let's insert a comma. And here it says the value if true. I'll insert in quotes, and then let's type in great job, then quotes again. Then let's insert another comma, and now I need to specify what happens if it's false. So let's insert quotes once again, and then I'll type in you're making too many YouTube videos. Let's enter in a quote again, and then let's close it out. And here it says great job, because right now we could see that Sunday cookies sold are greater than 300. But let's say that we only sold 290 cookies. I'll now update this cell's value, and look at that. If I scroll over to the right-hand side, here it tells me that I'm making too many YouTube videos. Maybe I need to focus more on this cookie baking business. This is just a simple example, but you can build some very powerful logic using if functions. If you want more structure when entering in your functions, with this cell selected that contains the if function, we can go up to the top bar right over here and we can click on this FX icon. This opens up the function arguments. Excel walks you through each part step by step. It even shows a description of what the function does and what kind of data you need to enter and even what each part resolves to. Let's close out of this view. Again, these are the most common functions you'll probably use. Once you know these, you're ready to handle most day-to-day tasks in Excel. If you want to explore all the different functions Excel has to offer, right up on top, let's click on the Formulas tab, and this opens up the Formulas ribbon. Here you'll see the Function Library, a group of dropdowns organized by category. Right over here, we have financial functions, logic functions, text, date and time, and the list goes on and on. If you're not sure what a function does, you can simply hover over it, and there you'll see a short description of what that function does. This is a great way to discover new tools and learn what's possible with formulas and functions, even if you're just starting out. Let's quickly talk about absolute versus relative references, something that confuses a lot of Excel beginners. By default, when you copy a formula, Excel adjusts the cell references based on where you paste it. That's called a relative reference. And let's take an example just so it makes sense. Right down below, we summed up this list of all the cookies sold throughout the week. Let's copy this formula and let's click into the cell right next to it and paste it. And there you see that it pastes zero. The reason why is the reference changed. With this cell selected, let's go up to the formula bar and click in here, and here we can see the reference. We pasted it in one cell over, and so the reference also changed by one cell over to the right. But what if you don't want it to change? Let's delete this formula that we just pasted, and let's go into the original cell with the sum function. Let's go up to the top toolbar, and right up here, let's insert a dollar sign in front of the column and the row. And here, we'll do it down here as well, and then press enter. Now, when I copy and paste this function and paste it into this cell, look at that, it's exactly the same. Now, no matter where you copy that formula, it will always pull from the original reference. As a quick shortcut, instead of manually entering in the dollar sign in front of both the column and the row, you could also press the F4 key to toggle on or off the dollar sign in front of those different columns and rows. Knowing when to use an absolute versus relative reference can save you from a lot of copy and paste headaches. If this saved you time or your spreadsheet, give it a like and consider subscribing. Got a function you want me to cover in the next video? Drop it in the comments. I'll see you in the next video.